Okay, we'll go ahead and get started for today's forum. Hi, everyone. My name is Maria Antonia Montes, and welcome to the U.S. Institute of Peace. I am a program assistant for the Latin America program and assistant to Virginia Bouvier, who unfortunately couldn't make it to today's event. Our work is focused on supporting the resolution of the internal armed conflict in Colombia, and we have done so by creating and hosting the Colombia Peace Forum for the past 2.5 years as a space to educate the public on the peace process, which began in 2012 in Havana, Cuba. We are honored to host this event on women working towards reconciliation with our guests from GemPaz, an ecumenical women's organization from Colombia. We welcome Norma Inés Bernal, Monica Guerrero, and Monica Velasquez, who arrived last night from Bogota, to share and discuss the work they're doing in reconciliation, transitional justice, and psychosocial support for victims affected by the armed conflict. Some small agenda items to share. Be sure to fill out your evaluation cards and hand them to me at the end of the afternoon. This event is webcast and live, and it's on the record. And if you'd like to join us via social media, our hashtag is #ColombiaPeaceForum. At your seats, there are headsets for simultaneous translation. Our interpreters are in the back booth. Please adjust your headsets to English or Spanish, changing the channels on the box in front of you. If you have a question during the discussion, please press speak at the box. Thank you all for attending today's event. I'll now pass it over to Susan Hayward, Director of Religion and Peacebuilding at USIP, who will introduce our guests and their work. Thank you.
Thank you, Tonas. It is such a treat to be here for you today, standing in imperfectly for Ginny Bouvier. Everybody take a pause to send up a little prayer for her. She's under the weather. My name is Susan Hayward, as Tona said, and I am the director of the religion program at USIP. I've been working at USIP for coming up on 8 years. And what's a special treat about being here today is that working with the ecumenical group of women peace builders in Colombia was one of the first projects in which I became involved when I started here in 2007. So, little story. I arrive here, and my predecessor in the religion program had done some work in Colombia previously, bringing together Protestant, Pentecostal, Mennonite, as well as Catholic peace builders in Colombia. As many of you know, if you're Colombia watchers, you know that the church and the churches in Colombia are very influential and have played a role in numerous ways in supporting both track one, official peace processes and negotiations, but just as importantly, doing a lot of work at the local level on addressing violence and supporting victims of the many forms of conflict that have ravaged Colombia for decades. And so I was sent down in order to see how we could continue to support the work, the really good work that was being done by faith communities in Colombia. And what I found when I went down there were a lot of women who were doing incredible work through their churches, doing it as individuals within their religious communities, both Protestant and Catholic, but had also been doing some work ecumenically. But it wasn't getting as much support as some of the other initiatives. And so together we talked about how we could better support and strengthen and bring together some of the work around the country that women were doing through their faith communities. And thus was born the Ecumenical Women's Peacebuilding Network, which it has been such a blessing for me to be able to watch and learn from the women in Colombia as they've continued to build this network over the past 7 years and to see the incredible work that they've done. And it has so inspired me that it actually led me on a multi-year initiative looking at the role of religious women and religious women leaders in peace-building efforts around the world across different religious traditions. And on the way in, you might have seen a notice for a publication for a book that's coming out in September that is looking at some of the findings of how religious women work through religious institutions and the challenges and the opportunities they face in doing so. And this book, I don't know if I told you this, my friend, mi amigas, but this book was very much inspired by these women here and the work that I had done with them. So again, it's so wonderful to welcome them here to the Institute and to be able to listen to them and continue to learn from them and to invite all of you in to hear from them as well. So with us today, we have Norma Ines Bernal, who had previously served as the leader of the Conference of Religious Orders on the women's side within the Catholic Church, and now serves on the steering committee of the Ecumenical Group of Women Peace Builders. We have Monica Velasquez, who serves as the project coordinator for the Ecumenical Group. And then we have Monica Guerrero, who has been serving as part of the steering committee for several years with the Ecumenical Group as well. So I believe you're speaking in that order. Is that right? Okay. So normally, Ines, take it away. En español.
Well, good afternoon, all of you. We appreciate your presence and your love for Colombia and the love that you have for us. I'm going to talk about from a role from the transitional justice in this framework of the peace process in Colombia, having in consideration the pre and post conflict. And I'm going to tell you why pre-conflict and why pre-agreement and post-conflict. I'm going to start with a biblical phrase, living the spirit, seeing the oppression that they're being subject to, listening to their complaints and listening to their suffering, it compromise or commits to the liberation process. Exodus 3rd. And from that we see how can doing an analysis, a continuous analysis about religion, about reality. We see new faces, but from the passing of time. So what the needs are going to get diversified, the kids, the little children, the youth, they are victims of the dissolution of the family ties for all this world that we're going under. They're also suffering from addiction, from corruption, from the drugs, from the armed forces, from the social media. Women, we are the ones that are doing the struggle, and we are also suffering all sort of violence because we are trying to be the defense of to continue with the patriarchal society. The violence that the results of this, or to try to look for a way to live, and what it does is that it creates a lot of victims, and what is happening is that creates a lot of increments the violence around the city. Women are suffering new every day. They're suffering new violences, new attacks against their new aggressions. The work for inclusion, for peace and their reconciliation, it's very important, it's very urgent. In which way we can really open in order to perceive these questions that we are getting with the changing reality, with which ways we use in order to sharpen our senses, to hear, to see, to feel, so our insights can be able to move against these oppressions. So in this frame of potential things that we can, in order to build peace and reconciliation in Colombia, we find the work of women that are united, a lot of women that are in different fields. But in this particular case, the ones that are belong to different churches, and then we weave together and we work together with different parts of the civil society in order to invest, research, and create and build, because right now building is a key word in Colombia, and then to work from the faith, from the point of view of the faith, and many of them are seeing are victims, and they have developed a way of resisting violence, and they have able to achieve very important goals in the equity of the gender. As a woman of faith, we support socially and psychosocial support and with when we build the peace and reconciliation. And we are able to provide space, secure and safe space to gather together, to recognize and to build non-violence ways to exit the conflict. This safe space and safe environment is very important for Colombia. Recognizing this and building this non-violence, non-violent exit to this conflict is going to let us unite efforts to, in order to, from different faith, be able to reconciliate, able to create deep transformations in this very historical moment that we are living as a country. What are we doing? No, it's not a lot, but we wanted to do it well. We go with the hope of achieve this peace process, and for that we are trying to look for social resources, political resources, spiritual resources, religious resources, in order to break with the inequality that has facilitated the oppression of many social groups. What the peace process works in different actions that allows us to be able to have more equity and allow us to have a very a successful, a fruitful life. So from there, we are applying the Resolution 1325 for United Nations from 2005, regarding that is a referent in order to guarantee the participation of women participation in the negotiation process, of the peace negotiation process, and opens the door to, in order to consolidate our participation in these peace agreements that we are confident are going to be signed. We work also for the to heal and the people that have been women or men that have been affected by the violence, victims that are direct and indirect victims, and that implies the reparation, complete reparation. And also we can do this through a spiritual help, and we can only help, we can only do this with a very inner freedom, a complete inner freedom. We allow the participation of different churches, so the victims and other they can participate from different point of views, and we are helping them in the process to forgive and also to heal. As women, nonviolent women, we want to invite in participation in an event that James and I were not long ago in Colombia. The leaders from churches, we have contributed to the violence in Colombia. We feel now that it's urgent to recuperate the culture of forgiveness, and we need to, because we want to let that behind, the vengeance sentiment, the constant feeling of needing to bend vengeance, and that's why we need to move forward. And we were helping to restore the social social framework in our society in Colombia. We are trying to build social, be able to live with different communities, so it allowed us to create new conscience, so it will remind us that violence is not just the only, it's not the only way, and together men and women can transform the pain and the uncertainty in an engine that is able to build a better reality. As we were saying by a theologist, Adelaida Jimenez, she lives in Barranquilla, Colombia. Other of the challenges another challenge that the women have in the reconciliation process in the context of the post agreement is to see the role that the women have in rebuilding that and becoming mediators. So why are we talking about a pre-agreement? Because we talk about agreement, the peace agreement in the Havana, as an agreement that is going to be signed between the government and the FARC. It's not exactly the process of the post-conflict. The process of post-conflict is the one that we dream to build as a society after the agreement has been signed in the Havana. So that's why I do talk about two different spaces. Other thing that we do is to encourage the restoration of between different government agencies with social organizations in order to give some input from what is happening with the armed conflict. And it's because there is a lot of mistrust. There is a lot of in between the social society and the government. So we want to create a bridge between two shores. We want to look at the history and be able to see what is the reality that we have. We are looking to rebuild, and we want to not repeat our actions, or we want to be able to look at the good images of a good life and the way to solve conflicts in the future. Mainly, we want to rebuild the ethical frames and the reasoning that allows us to live together, and the legal framework, and from the justice point of view also, that we have that in the evangelical point of view. It's very important in the pre-agreement and in the post-agreement. And this is very important because the justice can be, in essence, a loyalty act and a solidarity act that supports a community, an organized community. We're trying to develop the power, the local power, in order to build stronger relations. And that implies to be able to help victims and also the aggressors, so we are able to overcome and we can reach reconciliation. We want to help. We want to tell people that they don't have to supply or satisfy all the needs, but we want people to be able to exercise all their rights and enjoy all their rights. As the International Women Table says, this implies that we have to change our mentality. And this means that we have to open ourselves to new concepts and analysis. We have to discover how women were able to organize themselves to achieve what they were looking for, their goals. And they, we know the word exegesis is the study of the Bible. How do we interpret the biblical words and terms? So we have to see women from generating life, and also they can support in the social, be able to give support in social and in political order. We are developing safe spaces in order to be able to work with the victims of violence, especially women. It's very important to demilitarize our social life so we can be able to control and have control over our lives. The way to peace goes through the elimination of the force as a way of solving the conflict, that women can participate in social life, in a community life, and a political life without any fear. The insecurity of that happens on a daily basis, it has a great impact on women. How can we disarm people? How can we improve our community relations and the relations between one and another? How can we just not just frame people, situations, or conflicts? We are looking for a society in general to commit with ethical agreements that will help us as a new frame for to live in a society. And that's why we encourage the participation of women, as in the Women's Summit. And it's very important that the Truth Commission that is going to be created has a participation, a plural participation, and equity participation between women and men. So from a perspective of the human rights, women human rights, encourage the participation of women that have been victims, and that allow us to clarify the responsibility of different perpetrators. So, and this is being complemented by the ecumenical table saying, one, peace with ethic, and ethic for peace. In order to achieve this, we have strengthened women that have been leaders in order to have reconciliation in the local level. We started with Susan, and we want to continue with that. How are we going to do this? Giving tools to analyze the structural analysis from the church point of view, so we can analyze what is happening from the social, political, theological, and from different focuses and different spiritual point of views. We are giving tools that will allow us to rebuild the trust from victims and attackers. So we are trying to foment, to encourage participation spaces from the community with actions that will allow to repair victims and that would allow to rebuild our social environment. So that's why we join other people, we join other men and women. And at the end, I'll try to explain a little bit where we're trying to explain a little bit what is the ethical pact of women so we can understand a little bit better. But we do promote ethical agreements so we can overcome violence, inequity, and we can and inclusion, and to eliminate violence against women and girls to the local and national level. Human dignity implies and demands respect to life as the more sacred value. We do go to try to heal rage and hatred that will perpetrate violence. And in conclusion, from this first part, as the Pope Francis says, we'll have to go to the outskirts. We have to go, that means in Colombia, that right now we have to go to the process of the victims and with the pre-agreement and post-agreement. Because if we don't do that, then our mission is going to be obsolete. It's going to be a way of life, but without being close to reality. So what we have to see, we have to look for our real commitments in attached to what is the legal and social framework. And it has to be next to, we have to forgive, and we have to include everybody. So in order to do that, we have to continue and be hearing, and we have to have a dialogue, an active dialogue, listening actively. And then we have to study the public policies that are going to come out of that process in order to work hand by hand with different faiths in order to open to the civil society, to open our horizons to a new cooperation, ecumenical cooperation and interfaith, and in general with society. We are convinced that women are key in this process and this reconciliation process and this forgiveness process. And then we ask the people in Havana, as it says, the declaration of the Life Congress that we have in Bogota, that in Havana they have to set the basic lines that will allow us to stop the war in order to continue permitting the greatness of the human being, and then allows the restoration of the country, and then they should trust in the Colombian people that want to do deep changes, and then we can overcome injustice and exclusion. Today we come with real hopes. We started anew, and there was already a declaration from the cease, unilateral cease of fire from starting July 20th, and we are working in the bilateral cease of fire. They're working on that, and then be able to more dynamic with the negotiations. So this is giving us a lot of hope and allow us to keep on working. And then we cannot let behind or not forget that in the gospel says, you are the salt of the earth, you are the light of the world. And I think that's very important that we should believe on that. Thank you.
Thank you again for the invitation, Susan. It's a pleasure to be here in Washington with friends, people that we always see in Colombia, that we share workshops and spaces. James, thank you so much for your support and your facilitation process in other spaces in Colombia. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the psychosocial support in regional women's circles. We work with women in different regions in Colombia, and that has been a very important process, and it's the psychosocial process. So we begin from a point that without the psychosocial support and emotional support, it would be very difficult to be able to reconcile without that process of facing yourself. It's very difficult to restore that peace with other people that at a moment were aggressors. The psychosocial support also takes a process of restoration, and this is also responsibility of the state. Unfortunately, in different investigations that have been reviewed and that I have participated on, the victims do not feel fully satisfied with the psychosocial support that they have received. Many of them have been called to give testimony for a legal process, but they never take into consideration their pain, their suffering, the people that died, their husbands, the children that died in the process, in the conflict process, or everything that means to be a victim of displacement. So this process is new from the law 1448, and now there's support to victims, but in investigations, there's in research that we've done, there's not a lot of satisfaction from the victims and the psychosocial side. We understand the psychosocial process as an integral and very important part of this as a collective piece, and we think that we need to restore that social weaving from the community, the neighborhood in which these people come from. Sometimes they have to leave their spaces, and how this is not an easy process. It's a very painful process, and it has to be a collective process so that they can have better results. In 2013, we have a report that was presented by a group of women in the Pacific Route a couple of months ago, and we see different stories of a lot of suffering, very difficult stories where women have lost people and they're confused. There's a lot of suffering, a lot of women that are not very close to conflict, and they say, well, this is not part of my life, but I had to go through this. There are also stories about a lot of male control in these different territories, but also of their bodies, and how sexual violence has been another way in which conflict has taken place, and it's another tool of war against women. Also, in different processes, we understand that this psychosocial support is very important to recover a project of life that has been lost and that has to be restored at an individual level, but also at a community level. So in our association, we've started to provide different tools, not so much as a therapy, but in a way, yes, but it's more a collective piece, group support, and we give and provide space to women so that they can heal and develop again that resiliency and give abilities so that they can overcome a very difficult conflict. And we also help other women so that they can help other people and other women that have gone through this. That's why the circles in these regional circles, as Norma, as our sister Norma was saying, and Susan, this was very important at the beginning when we were starting this group. We practiced something that is called facilitated dialogue, and this is a tool in which we can talk and listen and understand the other person, and in which victims and ex-combatants and different participants can start healing and restore things that were taken away from them. Not all of us have been direct victims in this conflict in Colombia, but we also have roots and maybe family, parents, in this conflict that took place 40 years ago. So these people are also hurt, and they have consequences because of this. If you take into consideration that we've been in conflict for 50 years, and this has consequences. So these spaces are spaces so that we can talk about suffering and pain, in which sometimes in our lives we don't have time to talk about suffering, and conflict can be a very political topic or subject. And basically, to talk about pain and suffering is not important, but in this space, we can talk about this, we can talk about truth. And I think this is a very important subject. Commissions of Truth, we call them like that. We do memory exercises in which the victims and people that were direct victims can do these memory exercises in which they can talk about what happened, and the truth that takes place is not judged. So this process of reconciliation can be achieved because when we clear out everything with the truth, it's difficult sometimes to forgive and reconcile. We have talked about the fact that we work as an association that strengthens spiritual values, and we try to recover hope and forgive and forget. Because when you do not forgive, you still have feelings of hate and bitterness because of your loss. Also bitterness, anger, and other things. We also believe in dignifying all the parties, inclusive ex-combats and other participants like victims, direct victims, indirect victims, and other people that participate in these circles. We think that in this way we can also achieve reconciliation, which is a process in which we're working in our country, even though there's no that conflict like it was before. We're trying to reconcile after some time. This process of forgiveness and psychosocial work, it's also a complete work that we have to build all the time, but it's also holistic. And we try to recover the initial situation, in which it's going to take time, but we're trying to rebuild and start all over again. All the parties that participated in this conflict have different responsibilities. The state and the antagonist and all the parties on the other side. And this is key when we talk about the reconciliation process, to accept responsibility so that this is not repeated again. And how this psychosocial process, which is individual and as a group, generates conditions so that you can believe in yourself again and in other people. We also talked about the way that we also work in different values, spiritual values, and we think that when we celebrate all together, something that has been missed, which is trust and hope, we can have a new beginning, and this would be a point, a very strong point, so we can start all over again and heal everything that has happened to us. As faith, as women of faith, in the circles we also facilitate, as I said before, dignity and equity, faith as principles, Christian principles or spiritual principles, but also your own faith, faith in yourself. Because faith and the word of each other has been lacking in this at this time. We also have a process of thinking of ourselves and taking care of ourselves, body, soul, and spirit, and how to link everything together in this complete process to heal, and how you can relate to other people in this reconciliation with yourself, which is going to help to make peace with other people. And as we said, this is a process in which we train, we support, but we also think that this process, support of psychosocial process, is going to help to reconcile, and we think is needed. We have forgotten about this important piece, and it's a very important topic, and not all of the victims have received the support, and that's why we think of the safe spaces in which we can talk and listen to each other, pray and celebrate in different ways, even though there are differences, religious differences or differences in beliefs. But we also think that women are empowered to participate in different regional spaces, and some of the women that we work with come from regions that are far away from Bogota. We live in Bogota, but some of these women live in small villages in the rural areas and small cities. To end or close, I want to say that women in my country still have dreams and projects, and we have a hope to live in a peaceful country. We have a lot of faith in the peace process from Havana, and this inspires us to be stronger at a rural level or local level, and this inspires all of us to continue with this project, to continue working with this personal suffering and to face violence in a better way. This would be a little bit of what I wanted to share with you, and maybe later on I can clear something out for you or answer questions.
Bueno, nuevamente muchas gracias.
Again, thank you so much for inviting us. Thank you for the people that are committed to the work that we're doing in Colombia, and to all the people that were interested in listening to us and knowing a little bit more of what we're doing. Within what we're doing in GemPaz, we're also going through a training process, and that's when we start with the restorative justice challenge, because in Colombia we have a lot of violence in our history, and even though we're talking about new times in which we want peace and we want to achieve peace, we just talk about this as a concept, but when we go to the daily life, we know that we have a big challenge to transform this concept and transform our lives and the way that we want to do it and achieve long-lasting peace. And we don't want it to be just a document. We want to have a complete transition. So we have different experiences in different places or different cultures like South Africa, Canada, New Zealand, and Belgium. But we are focused on this justice process and the restoration of justice. We stop thinking about me as a person or he or what I want, but we try to put ourselves in the other person's shoes, and that's when we need to start understanding and find different pieces in this process, the victims, the aggressors, but the community as a whole. Sometimes we only focus on two people, but really the community as a whole has been affected. In this process, we see that in Colombia, in the daily life, there are a lot of feelings of hatred and vengeance. And this is a more reactive process. So when we think about peace, this has to go further down than just talking and having a dialogue. This has to be a state dialogue and a complete dialogue. And that doesn't affect me daily, not only focus on what bothers me. In GemPaz, we started this process after we started getting training. And we as a group, we have some alliances with other associations, and we have different partnerships that share trainings with us. So we're always thinking about the women and spirituality. Those are the key subjects. Word, God, Jesus Christ, and his life to be able to achieve the construction of peace in Colombia. We also learn from the restorative justice through different programs and experiences. This mainly talks about some moral principles and ethical principles, and that's basically what gives us support as a group to recognize each other and this subject about changing our thoughts. In Colombia, we're always thinking about how to punish the other, but when we think about restorative justice, you have to change this, and Colombia is in the process of learning this. Sometimes we hear from the news to reduce some penalties for crimes, and we think this is not fair, but when we talk about restorative justice, we need to know that we have to work in a complete way. When we go back into history, we can understand history and understand what is going on with other people to complete this cycle. And when we look in our personal history, we can think that when we're talking about blaming or punish other people, we have to go further away and to see where this cycle of violence started or why this person reacted or behaved that way, and we're going to be able to understand better. Nelson Mandela says our mission in the future is to advocate to heal the wounds of the country and building trust between each other, and not to start the battle against each other. Unfortunately, that's what we see in our country sometimes. In our daily life, we always try to see who's a bad guy, who's a good guy, and that has been affecting all of us. As women of GemPaz, we also learned that we have three pillars to understand that there's a damage and to recognize the damage. And we're not going to talk only about the victim as a person, but also the victim in the community. And that's why we consider that at many times the origin has not to be an individual one. We have to go further down to the community as a whole. And that's why restorative justice cannot focus only on one person, but in general. The second pillar is the responsibility of the aggressor or the victim, not only on the aggressor, but also to understand the third parties and to understand how these people have been affected by listening. It's a listening process, and it's very important that the aggressors acknowledge this offense. This implies accepting responsibility to try to heal the wound in a symbolic way. Sometimes we know that not always we have the chance to face the aggressor, but there are other symbolic ways to heal and restore this. Also, direct participation, in which people can accept their mistakes, and this goes more into the legal frame. And this is a process in which we can have an honest dialogue, open dialogue, in which we can express ourselves, but we also need to have mediators, because there are a lot of emotions that can come out. So there are different aspects that can happen in this process. Donna Hick, expert of Harvard, has been in Colombia many times, and she says that when you punish someone, you see that person as an enemy, and that's our problem. At many instances, when we're in this process, we see the other person as an enemy. What justifies the dehumanization of the other person? And that's why, to overcome conflict, Colombians have to replace the mentality of the good guy and the bad guy, and to put ourselves in their shoes. And this is very important, and we need you to see ourselves not only as a whole, but as a person. It's not only about the good guy and the bad guy. GemPaz has a lot of potential to be able to help in healing with restorative justice. And as women of faith, we need to know these principles and to love other people, where we give life, and not only in a maternal way, but also has to do with identity and to recognize ourselves as women and identify ourselves and to start something new, to be brave and to support victims. Women are very important because they've been there and supporting other people, other victims, and to help them overcome trauma. And women have been in that process, so to help other people to trust themselves, and we can achieve that in our spaces. And basically to listen these voices. In GemPaz, we are going to continue to provide these tools to restore justice and to train women in different regions in regards to different subjects, legal subjects, healing, and also the process of repairing the lives of the victims. We have started to work in this, and spirituality has helped all of us to provide this assistance to other women. And we are trying to get better prepared and to have a better relationship with the two parties to be able to start a process in which we are going to be able to include victims, but also to ex-combats and the community as a whole. So we are in the process of training, as my colleagues mentioned. So we are trying to have gender equality and restorative justice, 1325 Act from United Nations. And this is a huge process to reconcile with different communities. The restoration is focused in a spiritual way, emotional way, and also to heal other people and to reconcile. And we have tried to base ourselves in which is the gift of God, what He gave us. And this is a very important principle and where we come from, because this is going to basically overcome all challenges. If it's only us, we would have just basic processes of dialogue, but we're able to experience that through the gifts of God, we can overcome anything. And of course, we're going to guarantee that there's not going to be a repetition and that there's going to be healing in this new process that we're working with OSIP. We are creating different processes for restoration in Colombia, and we're identifying many women that have been working with us for some time, and we're going to continue working with them to restore and to overcome those wounds that have been left through violence in our country, and that sometimes we just leave it to the legal framework, but we cannot forget what is the legal justice and the state. From our perspective in GemPaz, we started working 3 years ago with ecumenical groups, and these are open spaces in which women can come to us and look to restore their lives and through the tools that we provide. So we have different study groups. We have different points in which we start with a biblical context, and then we start studying the story of each woman individually. We also work in different circles with different legislations, and we work in restoring dignity and symbolic topics with celebrations and political incidents, and we try to deeply hear and understand these people to be able to support them. In the circles, we also work so that we can talk about forgiveness, and we can talk to restore trust, so that we can understand that the end point is not jail. We know that that's not going to change anyone. And in this way, we can restore and heal that damage that was caused, and to feel that there has been justice. In the same way, in different regions, we've been working with different circles of women, so we can work with the community as a whole, not only as a group, as a small group, but we want to go and prepare women so that they can apply the same tools and provide these tools in different communities and different regions. We acknowledge that the political situation in Colombia right now is not the best. We have different challenges, as Norma was saying, with different negotiations of the government and as far, but we have that hope. Sometimes we can say that it comes from us because we're women and we have more faith. We have that faith in life, and we always live with that, and we think that Colombia is going to change. It might not happen in this generation, but we're basically cultivating this change so that we can change social justice. As women, we are trying to transform our country and to have public and social action. Sometimes we can have public action with our spirituality, and that's going to be key in the spaces that we have, and to continue our impact and have a real impact. To us Colombian women with faith, we're trying to rebuild peace from our inside. If we start with our inner peace, we're going to transform not only our self-beings, but society. Women have to keep fighting to open spaces and to overcome the battle. We have to stop having fear to rebuild peace and have a better position with strong roots and start initiatives with strong content. It's necessary to avoid that the word of peace can be captured to the silence of weapons. So in GemPaz, we have to understand that peace is not only one piece. It has to start with our inner peace, and we can build more and provide more to society. Thank you so much.
Thank you to...
Pero veo a Angélica Rincón allí. Angélica es...
See Angélica Rincón, that she's back there, and she is the one, the leader that lead the Ecumenical Circle in Bogotá. I just wanted to give her a shout out.
Addition to the commentary from USIP and ICRD, so just give us 2 minutes to transition into our next panel, and we'll begin with introductions.
And I'll just say that the second panel, it's just going to be brief comments from everybody, and then we're going to have plenty of time for questions. So if you have questions, we'll get to them, I promise. Just write it down so you don't forget. Hello again, everybody. So now for round two, which is just going to be some brief reflections and feedback from a number of people who have a lot of expertise and experiences from around the world working with women in the midst of violent conflict, working on issues of reconciliation in the midst of and in the aftermath of violent conflict, and with the role of faith communities, and working especially with the Women of Faith Network in Colombia. So Kathleen Keenast is the director of the gender work, the senior advisor of the gender work of the US Institute of Peace. Lily Cole is with our Academy for Applied Research where she has done a lot of work looking at the role of reconciliation, of truth commissions, of transitional justice in the aftermath of violence. And James Patton is the executive vice president of the International Center for Religion and Diplomacy. And he has been working on issues of the role of faith communities in the midst of violent conflict, with the sensitivity and understanding of how gender dynamics intersect with that, with ICRD, and has worked quite a bit with the Ecumenical group in Colombia over the recent 2 years. So I'm just going to start very briefly by saying part of what you hear in the stories of how the Ecumenical group is working in Colombia as women faith leaders, and what you can see from that, from lessons that we are able to draw generally from the work of women religious leaders in the midst of violent conflict and peace building. And there's four themes that I want to point to. One is the phenomenon of working especially on cross-group or interfaith, inter-ethnic basis for doing peace work. What we found is that women generally, women of faith in particular, tend to gravitate to this kind of work that brings people together across lines of conflict, lines of difference, and sometimes lines of violence in the midst of conflict. And when we pushed a little bit at that to understand why women gravitated toward this kind of work in particular, we found a couple things. One was the emphasis on relationships, and especially the fact that women are particularly vulnerable to violence in the midst of violent conflict, forms of violence related directly to the conflict itself, but also some of the secondary forms of violence that result from violent warfare, including sexual violence, including institutional violence, lack of access to education and to health resources, and so on. And so there's an experience of shared suffering, shared victimization across lines of difference in the source of violent conflict that seems to bring women together as a form of solidarity, but also in a very practical way, as a way to have more political, social, economic influence. So women have to build these coalitions in the midst of violent conflict because they can't do it alone within one community or another if they don't have the kind of access to political decisions within their state institutions, which they often don't, or to armed groups, which tend to be more male-dominated. Of course, Colombia, there's a lot of women within the FARC and so on, and you see that in other circumstances as well. But it's for these kinds of reasons we found that a lot of women of faith tended to gravitate towards that kind of intergroup, interfaith work. Number two is the ways in which women religious involved in peace building draw on theologies that legitimate and support their work in two ways that are influential for their own work, but also for the wider society. And one is what you see in religious peace building generally, which is that religious peace builders tend to draw on and pull out those theologies, those religious ideas, those religious stories that support peace, support the values that are important to peace, compassion, loving kindness, and so on. But that women of faith do something else. They're not only drawing on those theologies and stories, but they're also drawing on the theologies that empower and support their role as women doing this work, and that speak to the dignity of women who experience violence and who experience oppression. And you see this a lot in the work of the Ecumenical Group of Women Peacebuilders in Colombia. Let me give you one example of a workshop I was in where they were reenacting dramatically stories from the Bible, of women within the Bible, including stories of women who have been the victims of male violence and sexual violence in the Bible. There's plenty of stories that you can draw from within our Holy Scriptures that bring attention to, draw attention to those experiences that women face as victims and survivors of male violence. And so they draw from those stories in order to make sense of and kind of draw a sacred, holy lens to those experiences that women face in Colombia. But they're also drawing from the experiences of women who have been leaders within the Christian faith, within the Bible, to legitimate their own role as community leaders in peace building to those who would otherwise try to restrict them within the religious sphere and within the secular sphere. So there's this virtuous cycle of drawing from religion in order to transform various forms of oppression and violence. Three is that the women of faith peace builders tend to operate very close to communities, and they understand, in working with the various communities and people affected by violence, they understand in ways that are not exclusive to Women of Faith Peace Builders, but are very particular to them, the multiple and intersecting forms of violence within violent conflict situations and how it impacts different people in different ways, but is all related. And I think you heard that a little bit in their presentation about seeing how many different groups are caught up in a system of violence and oppression, and about how the minor injustices and the major injustices that affect different people, different ethnic groups, different racial groups, different gender groups, different political groups within the society are all interwoven. So that issues of gender justice and issues of violent conflict, political conflict and injustice that's driving the conflict large are very intermixed, and you can't deal with one without the other. And then they also brought in, which a lot of faith communities do, that the issue of personal transformation too, and personal violence, and the ways in which, especially for those who have been victims of violence and sexual violence, need to sort of heal and reconcile within themselves before they can seek to reconcile the larger society or bring peace to the larger society. So seeing those multiple forms. And then a fourth is that often in the ways in which religious peace builders generally, I think, but especially women of faith peace builders, operate in designing and implementing their peace programs, the process often reflects the goals that they're seeking to achieve. And so having watched the ecumenical group form over the past several years, I can tell you that there's been inclusivity in all decision-making. All of the women from the different backgrounds, those living in Bogota, those outside of Bogota, in the rural communities from whom they're speaking of, those Catholic, those evangelical or Protestant, they're all participating in the decision making about where the group goes, about what kinds of issues it focuses on. And it's that kind of inclusive process that's sensitive to the power dynamics within different groups, between different groups, majority and minority and so on, that reflects the goal that they're trying to achieve within the society at large. So I'll end there.
Thank you, Susan. And I wanted to just take a moment and recognize Jenny Bouvier, who is listening. I wrote her, and so to say hello and to thank her for her leadership here at USIP for at least the last 8 years while I've been here, and her dedication, and also to acknowledge the panel that preceded us on your work. It made me look up a Martin Luther King Jr. quote. He's somebody I think a lot about, and I read a lot about when it comes to really looking at restorative justice. And I thought of you all when I reread this quote. He says, human progress is neither automatic nor inevitable. Every step toward the goal of justice requires sacrifice, suffering, and struggle. The tireless exertions and passionate concern of dedicated individuals. And I have to believe that nearly everyone, if not everyone in this room, really comes under that term, dedicated individuals. And certainly how we bring that dedication into community is what you have all been addressing here today and over the years of this kind of dedicated work. I also came to recall, as you were speaking, my very first experience with peace building. It was in 1980, before most of you were born, and I didn't really know it, but I was a peace builder. I spent a summer in Northern Ireland at a reconciliation camp called Corrymeela, and my job was every day to hang out with Catholic and Protestant youth. And at night, I slept in tents between them. And that's really when the stories came, the narratives. And once I understood the accent, I was able to follow the stories, but they speak very rapidly. It starts at an early age there, I think. And what startled me was how early the narratives of hate, begin. Many of them were really quite young, you know, giving their parents a break for a week or something. And so, you know, they were 5, 6, 7. They were without that kind of what's right, what's wrong. They just kind of speak. And I remember coming away that summer that it is our stories that we repeat that get settled into the next generation, literally planted in their minds as a pathway, a flashlight to the future. And so as I was listening to your comments here today, I was thinking also of the role of parents, mothers and fathers, and the stories that they tell as you move through this very treacherous path. Another quote that comes to me of Martin Luther King is that peace is not the goal, it's the path. It's a hard path. It's much more difficult than the war. And you know that in a very deep way. Another thing that came to me while you were speaking, and I really wanted to be spontaneous here, so it's working as you were speaking, but I wanted to draw your attention to what I think is a seminal piece in the development world. This year, the World Development Report, just released a month or so ago, is called Mind, Society, and Behavior. And you'll see my ragged version of it as I've been digesting it. And why I think it's important for peace builders is that it's important when economists and social scientists begin to adapt to the story of framing the narrative. You all know that story. But their own evolution in trying to understand poverty, in trying to understand violence, they are looking very seriously at this crossroads of how we think. And I kept hearing you all say, you know, it is our attitude. It is purposefully acting peacefully, taking, letting go, forgiving, loving. I mean, it is its work. And this was, this is actually so much a part of this new story. And if you're not familiar with the World Development Report, this happens every year. They take on an issue and they get some really best minds in the world trying to dissect an issue. And I think this one is important. First of all, they also begin to challenge our almost natural tendency to think in binaries. And I heard you all talking about that as well. And this is something we've been struggling with here at the Institute of Peace in how we understand what we call gender and peace building. And it's something that we say, and we don't say it lightly, but gender is not another name for women. I mean, we are born male or female in terms of a biological sex, but gender is really a social, cultural understanding, very, very adaptive ideal. And so I would encourage you, as you're thinking through your own narratives moving forward, that you take on a multi-dimensional perspective on and gender dynamics. We have begun to also kind of create a narrative here that is trying to understand that we're really not getting achieve gender equality, achieve a world without violence against women unless we engage men. And engage men as active parts of solving the problem. And so we have begun just a very small little pilot project called Unlearning Violence as a way to problem solving. And we think it's going to be possibly contribute to DDR programs. And I will tell you, the very first panel I think I sat on with Jenny was on DDR. And it started me thinking about how we leave out women in DDR, but we also create our own assumptions that people, once they're violent, are forever violent. And how do you unlearn violence in a society? And it takes both men and women moms and dads to reboot the narrative on all of this. So I wanted to lend you a couple of those thoughts, and also just to say that this kind of work takes great organizational skills, great fortitude. Susie was talking about community-driven peace building, and these are some of the hardest things I think faith communities have come to learn. Though it sounds so good, living in community is, I think, among the hardest things human beings endeavor to do. And so I say that, and again, with deep respect for the efforts that you each and all are making. And I'll just end again with another Martin Luther King quote. And if you're here for a couple of days, I strongly urge you to go to the memorial in his honor. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. And hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Good luck, and know that we're standing by you and with you in your efforts.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a real honor to be asked to speak here with people doing such wonderful work in Colombia. I have to say, I'm not a specialist in religion peace building. I'm not a specialist in gender, and unfortunately, I'm not a specialist in Colombia or Latin American affairs, although I have been to Colombia as part of a meeting on transitional justice and have great appreciation for the just fantastic creativity of the work being done there by the peace building and human rights communities. So I have only a few remarks, really, just one that comes from my more normative, I guess, ethically oriented side. But the first is actually a question for the panelists and maybe some others in the room as a way of introducing our work here at USIP. So I'm in our Center for Applied Research on Conflict. And we're not, we don't actually organize our work geographically, it's thematic. And what we're, our goals for our different streams of research, and mine is on reconciliation, our goals are to try to understand what are the practices being used in different fields in peace building, and what are the best practices, and how do we even decide how to ask those questions? And reconciliation has been very challenging. It's not a very specific, clear practice like the one my colleague works on, which is to combat election violence. Reconciliation is really a very difficult concept to implement and actually operationalize. So we are really trying to use social science research methods to better understand reconciliation, that is what people living out in conflict zones, what does it mean to them? Are there other concepts that are clearer? Does it mean social integration, social cohesion, trust building, building social capital, or some combination of those? And how can we find out where those good things are actually increasing and what practices can increase them? So this is a relatively new area of work. We are not beginning this work ourselves, but to try to promote some of the work and fund some of it and try to bring the findings back to our colleagues inside USIP and our partners outside USIP who are actually designing practices. So one big challenge is to say, well, how do we know that reconciliation is increasing in some way? How would we actually find that out? So my question is, this means that we need what we call in this field, this sort of monitoring and evaluation, indicators. What are the indicators? How would we know that reconciliation is actually increasing? And we actually don't have a lot of evidence at the moment. Different people, different countries are using different standards. There's a very well-known reconciliation barometer in South Africa. I think it's one of the earliest ones, and it's been copied elsewhere. There are some different tools in Cyprus that are now being tried in Bosnia and Nepal. There's one in Australia with quite a different focus, and I understand that there is one that's been developed in Colombia. But what I want to do, because we're so lucky to have you here today, is to take advantage of having almost a mini focus group and to put to you the question. If you imagine 10 years from today, I guess assuming that the peace agreement goes forward, what would you imagine as success in reconciliation? And something more specific, obviously, than just we have achieved a peaceful society. I was wondering if you or any of the other Colombians or Colombian Americans in the room would be interested in sharing with us, with me at least, some of the things that you would actually specifically imagine. What parts of social life or personal life would be the most important to look at, and what are the signs you would look for? Those are exactly the kind of questions we're trying to develop and then to carry out through surveys and interviews and other kinds of methods in our center. And then just quickly before I pass the word along to James Patton, I was really very interested by your talk on your work. And I'm very curious about the question of asking for forgiveness and or trying to encourage people to forgive. And I wondered why you chose that instead of asking people who've committed extremely violent crimes to repent and show signs of non-repetition. And that's actually mentioned in the GemPaz literature. It's a very, very impressive comprehensive mix of social reconciliation and transitional justice goals. So I'm curious to know what happens if you have victims who are not what we would call resilient, who have been really deeply harmed, or we have victims, many, many of them, who are actually dead. And what is our responsibility to them or the victims who are really not able to easily go on with their lives? And how is it possible to actually have a sign of non-repetition and security in the society if you have many perpetrators who don't want to repent? And the evidence around the world, I haven't seen very hard data on it. We showed a film last night on Indonesia based on interviews with perpetrators of a massive genocide there in the mid-1960s. And the majority of the perpetrators have expressed no remorse whatsoever. They actually brag in their lives and on the camera about what they've done. So this is my question. Should the first line of communication be to those who have committed crimes to ask them to express some form of repentance? And I was interested in hearing a little more about that. But thank you again so much.
Bueno, primero que gusto tener a mis.
Well, first of all, it's a pleasure to have my friends here at home. This is a group that I fully respect. It's so deep that I cannot even express it.
Por casualidad, the poem that Maritza wrote and read at the last event that we did. Voy a cambiar inglés, qué pena. This is one of the peacemakers from GemPaz, and just to illustrate how extraordinary some of these folks that we work with in the field are, in particular the women's group, there's a little firebrand of a religious leader named Maritza, who is part of the group, who is just fantastic. She's got to be in her closing in on 70 at least, right? And she stood up at the end of an event, a three-day event that we had, where by custom of GemPaz, in the middle of the room were the photographs of all of their friends and colleagues who had been, quote unquote, martyred during the violence in Colombia, working on peace issues, and a candle burning down in the middle. And she read this extraordinary poem about women as basically a broken clay vase within this process, within society, and how to restore that. And then she sort of jokingly said, well, now I'm going to head back home where the Águilas Negras, one of the big paramilitary groups, have just come and told me they're going to kill me again if I don't knock off doing what I'm doing. And she smiled and laughed, and off she went back to her house to continue her work. These are the kind of folks that are out in the field doing this kind of thing. I had the privilege of being interviewed on W Radio last week about a letter that was written by religious leaders that was sent to the Havana process, pleading with them not to give up on the process and not to return to violent means to try to end the conflict, which is an irony that I still haven't unpacked. But and I was asked by the interviewer, Claudia Malgin, okay, well, is this too little too late now that the Colombians have given up on the peace process and want to go back to violence? And I thought, which Colombians are you talking to? Because I'm talking to these Colombians, and that is not the case. For the first time since I started working in Colombia in 2006, I see optimism and I see hope in the field, particularly in the areas that are most impacted by the violence, not in the cities which are most impacted by political and media narratives. But the folks who have lived through the violence, and like the GemPaz group of about 300 women, the majority of whom are victims of violence, are trying to become reconcilers, trying to find a way to get through their own histories of pain and the historical wounds that they have suffered, and actually heal others on both sides of the victim-victimizer polarity, which is another—that's a punitive justice way of phrasing it, and we can get into the restorative justice way of phrasing it at another point. But it's pretty extraordinary the strength that that requires, right? So it's a privilege to have you here. It's a privilege to be part of the process. Colombia has lived at least 100 years of constant violence. I don't count that little window of like 2.5 years between la violencia and the current thing as peace, but. If you ask Colombians in an event, raise your hand if you know what peace in Colombia looks like, you get very few, if any, who raise their hand, and most of them would have been 3 years old at the time if they did. It's hard to know where to go in Colombia. There is extraordinary capacity within Colombia, but it is very hard to know what the path is. What is the way from here to there? Right, and so I think it's very easy to fall into these kind of facile descriptions of, well, this didn't work because, you know, the FARC has not, they're still kidnapping generals who wander onto their territory or killing soldiers, etc. Right, okay, this is all legitimate problems within a peace process. And when I was challenged by Claudia about, well, why are they still, you know, committing violence, I said, well, they're still at war. I mean, we're in a peace process, right? And so the reality is war, and there is no clean process out of violence and into stability, but there certainly isn't a clean process out of violence and back into violence either. So it's a deeply divided society, and unfortunately, I think that the spoilers are starting to really get a hold of the narrative. And we go back to some of what folks were saying before about reframing the narrative. I think of the photograph we saw out of Havana in the international press of FARC members lounging on a yacht as the single image that I think a lot of people have seen with respect to the Havana process. If you dig deeper into some of the periodicals or into some of the online materials, you'll see, for example, a few weeks ago, pictures of FARC and Colombian military on their hands and knees pulling anti-personnel mines out of the ground together. Why wasn't that distributed with the same force as this image that undermined the validity of the process? I mean, part of the reason is there are political interests in Colombia who have put extraordinary energy into undermining this process. Another part of the reason, I think, is we like the ease of who's right and who's wrong, rather than the complex difficulty of we're all a little bit right and a little bit wrong. So how do we map ourselves forward? I'm not keeping track of time either, so I'm sorry. Just give me a heads up. So how do we go forward? Well, the question in our minds, ICRD, from a practical strategic point of view, is who in Colombia holds the position of being recognized as a source of positive values for the future that can lead us to a somos colombianos instead of tú eres el malo, yo el bueno, right? Who holds that position after 100 years of constant identity violence? You know, whose identity is significantly enough removed and not tainted by the political underpinnings as well as the actual actions of violence that really kind of cover almost all of the Colombian society. So who can operate as a trusted third party to start to build a narrative and implement a narrative for reconciliation? Because peace building is not happening in Havana. Havana is a demobilization process. We pretty much all agree on that. Peace building will happen in the communities afterwards. And the Colombian communities are not prepared for that. So they need help. They need an idea. They need a way to articulate that idea. And they need the practical steps of taking them from what they've gone through to a way to recognize one another as fellows, even if they're not embracing and opening stores together. At least they're not trying to continue to live out the retributive violence that we've seen over and over and over in Colombian society. For us, there were two answers to that question. One was the kind of sacred role of women in Latin culture, and that's reflected in Colombian culture. Now, this doesn't mean that there isn't an extraordinary amount of interfamilial violence, because that is actually intrafamilial, probably interfamilial as well. That's actually far eclipses the violence from the armed conflict. It doesn't mean that there isn't an extraordinary amount of abuse and prejudice, but there is this kind of odd sacredness around the image of the woman in the family. I remember we're working with the Barras Bravas, with the gang members in Kennedy and Soacha, and these kids are out at 13 stabbing each other in the public square, but then they go home and the grandmother's like, clean up your room. Yes, ma'am. You know, I mean, there's a certain kind of odd place that this gender holds. It needs to be kind of recovered in a positive way, and there needs to be some stuff dealt with that is very grotesque and negative with relationship to the gender divisions. But it's a source of potential values, I should say. The second would be spiritual actors. This is not to say that the churches, and as it said in the letter that was sent to Havana, don't have a history of being tied into some of the armed groups, but that history has faded a little bit with reference to where it was, let's say, in the 70s and 80s in Central America and other places. And so they've recovered to some degree, and again, I'm painting with a pretty broad brush, but the image of a somewhat trusted third partner. The problem is that the religious organizations, religious individuals, are pathologically averse to working with one another. You know, we are actually trying to work across the entire spectrum of faith there, including indigenous and Afro-Colombian cosmovisions, to find a way to articulate a spiritual but non-doctrinal reconciliation process that all Colombians can access. And man, I'll tell you what, we're out in places like Corinto, and we can't get one evangelical pastor to work with another evangelical pastor down the road, much less with a shaman. I mean, it's pretty intense, but it's actually happening. We're moving forward, not just us, but the group Reconciliación Colombia, which is a public-private partnership that's working at the national level. So we're seeing advances there. So these are two sources of potential positive values. Okay, sorry, I could go on all day, but and I do sometimes, so just turn me off. That we're trying to mobilize. And of course, GemPaz, not just giving the examples of some of the individuals there, but they hold a very unique position to play the role of becoming the not only symbolic, which is very necessary in Colombia, change the narrative by showing what's possible, but the practical solution to processes of reconciliation. Not only because they are both religious and women, right, bridging these two sources of values, but they've done now 5 or 6 years under the guidance of Susie and Ginny. And Ginny, we miss you. I hope you feel better. Dengue and another pseudo dengue. Wow, better than I. But they've done 5-6 years of conflict analysis training and also ecumenical engagement. And frankly, the last event that we had there were indigenous women who did an indigenous rite. There was some conflict around that, frankly, but that's okay. And these are the places where these things can get hammered out, and the encounters of individuals with different cosmovisions can result in a new relationship that again can demonstrate to Colombians what is possible, because there is a very profound lack of optimism and a profound lack of believing that something else is possible. My wife is Colombian, and when I asked her about this project when I was first launching it, I said, what do I need to know about Colombia that I don't know? And she said, we don't believe anything can change. Right? And so these are the folks who can demonstrate change. There's a lot more I'd love to engage in terms of discussion, but I'll leave it there. And just again, I'm extraordinarily and eternally grateful that you all are doing what you're doing at incredible risk to yourselves. And thank you for being here and working with us.
I'm conscious of how patient all of you have been. And so as our friends from Colombia come back up here, I would like to begin to collect some of your questions. And Lily, we're gonna hold yours and come back to them as well, because they're very good ones. Just wanna give a chance for all of you to begin to raise your voice, your questions, your comments. And when you speak, can you please, first of all, make sure you turn on your microphone, but then also just say briefly who you are, which organization you're from.
English or Spanish? Okay. Spanish it is then. Buenas tardes.
Good afternoon. My name is Rodrigo. I'm from El Salvador, and I come in representation of Creative Associates International, and we work especially for USAID. My interest is in focusing the focus of Central America, Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras as countries that we have a tremendous violence process at the moment. And very similar to we are in this phase that we do not believe in anything. We have lost faith, we have lost hope that things can change. And part of what I want to find a tool or a way to start to change the mentality of the Salvadorian, of the regular Salvadorian that right now wants vengeance, if they want more death, they want to, instead of reconcile with this group. So I would like to hear more your opinion about what will be some of the tools or what's the narrative that we can share with this civil society that is basically giving up. Well, that's the question. That's the million-dollar question. In a forum that we had with mediators, women mediators that are mediators, one of the leaders, the Salvadorian leaders, said that one of the mistakes that were made in the Salvadorian process and the negotiations of the peace negotiations process had was that they didn't include any financial plan. And from that perspective, I think that that's why we are having that into consideration, that into the peace process, especially taking that the consideration your peace process. So that's why we've been working with different summits, the agrarian, the farmers summit, the women's summit, and how we can try to these different summits and these meetings from different NGOs and different social movements, how can we keep hope alive through those groups, and at the same time get together in bigger networks that will allow us to sustain ourselves. I think that that's a job, it's a very important job that is being done, and that is being done through your, thanks to your experience. The second thing that I think it's very important is the regard being the active, the exercise of active listening, and the circles that they have been, that have been forming in order to analyze and discuss and keep hope alive. So this does not ensure you anything. 4 days ago, we were able to do a survey about the peace process, and the result was that the 52% was believing in the peace process, 52%. So that means that with this struggle, with the struggle of keeping hope alive, is that we're dealing with, and in my opinion, that's our main role as a group, is to listen, to motivate, engage, and act and say, look, whatever goes, we have to maintain this process. Whatever happens, we have to maintain this process, and we have to maintain it and keep at it with the certainty that as a civil society, we have to rebuild. We are the ones who have to rebuild the path. So that's the thing, that those are two things, two important parts, and that I wanted to emphasize, and that I complement with the question that you were asking us about the groups, about the reconciliation groups. I think that one way of seeing what, something very important that we're doing in Colombia is try to the intervention in different process and the victim process, and to let victims be part of this process, of this reconciliation process. For that, there has been about a series of forum, regional forums, where victims have been able to talk, have been able to clarify, have been able to express what they feel, and the national forum, the national victim forum, that where we participated over 2,000 victims from 18 different areas, it was very important to see how these victims were talking. They were saying what they were feeling. And in the group, we were, at least in the group that I was in, something very important happened. And it was that how in a group, there was a girl that the ELN, they destroyed the village where she was from, and all her family was dead, was killed. And one of the leaders from that group, ELN, was there. And it was, and I was like, what can I do? What am I doing here? And that's what I was, I understood my role in that forum. So when she stopped talking, she basically, broke down, and she came to me, and I was there to hold her, to hug her. And the leader from the ELN, he stood up, he recognized his participation in that event, and then he asked for forgiveness. He asked that she will allow him to ask for forgiveness. So it was very important. This was a way, a very important way to start a reconciliation process that is not the same as a forgiveness process. So I think that the forgiveness process is very it's a personal process. It's a process that is not mandatory for reconciliation, but it is basic in order to have the spiritual process. And that's why as women of faith, we are sure that if we do not go with the forgiveness process and from the civil society in general is not going to be with us because they don't have the tools to do it. So if we work together, we all of us are able to start with this forgiveness process. So I think that the concept that what is in quote unquote our living is this post-conflict, that what you're living, that we expect to live at one point, it could be precisely that with the tools that we are dealing with this, the negotiation, and with the tools that we're going to have with the negotiation that we're going to have from the other guerrilla members, that is from the National Liberation Army, so we can have the possibility of whole hope. So for us, that and to sustain that hope, it's basic to work together with different groups. It's we cannot separate each other as churches, and we cannot let the have one morality govern over the other. I think we have to eliminate those moral issues, because if we continue like that, then it's gonna allow us to classify or point somebody out. But if we talk about ethic, is what it will allow us to keep the hope alive. So I don't think there is a formula, but there are paths that we have to build. Only to add, it's a challenge, it's a very long road, and I think that it's to guarantee the participation of the victims of the civil society, to continue with the public actions, even among the division and the mistrust. We have to continue, and we have to try to unify it all together. We have to be persistent. We in Colombia, we are in a process that every day we have to support this. Every day is like, it's like when you're holding something, that a glass object, so it's almost tumbling and you have to hold it tightly. So yeah, you have to do that. And also thinking about in general topics, the position of the church, the church position, it has been very important. The last week precisely was spread through an organic Christian organization that basically the point is don't stand up from the table, continue talking, even whatever, regardless of what is happening, because the hope continues. Even though is less now, we have to keep our hope. And it was just like a call to churches and different points of different aspects of the churches to continue to sign and to send a communique to Havana, do not stand up from the table. So in our process, as James said, we had an opportunity to have that process, the reconciliation process, and to continue and to go from theory to practice, and with two women that were ex-combats, and then we were in an annual meeting that we always have, and we were obviously working in this topic and this issue, and we knew that two ex-combat were going to come to join us, but we didn't know they were women. And then a group arrived, and there were men and women, and we were thinking that the two men that got there were the combats the fighters. But then they were started talking about us, and why was the reason why they got into the groups, why they entered this group. And one of them, during the guerrilla, during her time with the guerrilla, she didn't even carry weapons, but she was in that group. So we were able to listen to them, and to listen to them was very important to us, because we were able to put ourselves in their shoes and see their pain and see her pain and why she acted that way. So at the end,
of this meeting, we were able to do a prayer circle where we can able to feel that pain that they had, even though that we have felt as well as victims in the whole in this process. So we wanted to understand women that have come to the process and allow us to just take a lot of barriers that we have built through the years with this process. Thank you. First of all, I want to congratulate you and to thank you for this work that you have been doing and for to continue with this work. And also is I had the opportunity to live and work in Bogota with issues or topics that you have worked with. So my question, in order to get into the religious aspect and the importance of faith in Latin America and what it has represented to dozens of years for the women and for equity, gender equity. With all this work that you have done to see values as forgiveness and faith, hope, where is and how is it that, or how do you understand from the circles that you've been working, from the three where the three of you work, the equity, equity in the sense of rights in the global agenda that are in the global agenda of women, family, raising kids, and the sexual rights and reproductive rights, and besides topics that you have already mentioned before, everything that is related to sexual violence. So how do you see how we can refresh that Marian model? And strong, I'm attached, I forgive, I accept. So I like that proposal of a repentance instead of forgiveness. So if you can give me a little bit of the comments in that area. Good afternoon. Thank you so much for your interventions, for your participations. They are very inspiring, very interesting. My name is Claudia Naves. I just graduated in Notre Dame from Peace Studies, and I came, and I have a lot of reasons to be in this event. The question was already done from the panelists, but also a personal reflection. I work with people in the conflicts, women victim of the armed conflict, and this has started as a circle where women will come and tell their stories and the memory reflection, and then at some point women started saying, no, we have to be able to create an impact in the government, and that's how in Uganda they started participating in the government, and a men group also said that they wanted to do a net to work together. So my question is, how can we do these processes in order to involve men as well, and how has been your experience to expand this with the reconstruction the social fabric, and how we can work with the communities?
Bueno, sobre la pregunta, yo la traté un
About that question, I think I talked a little bit about that when I was speaking. How can we, how can we leave that model of stop giving services and receive rights? And I think that we still have to move a lot, we have to advance a lot in that area. And regarding churches, I think there is a mission, and that's a true mission, a very important mission, because there is women have been subject to what is churches and what have been the concepts of the opinions of pastors, of clerics, clergy, etc. So I think that is that's a challenge. That's a challenge to tell women we have to we have to receive rights in order to give rights. So in order to get in this ethical path for women, it's in English. You can go there to the website. It's in English, but unfortunately I only brought it in Spanish. But there is a series of topics that are keys and that are specific about the right to life and right to personal freedom. And I think that even ourselves, we have to keep working every day in order to free ourselves. And as you said about the Marian Circle, that is really, I have to answer that because I'm the Catholic one. I think that the model, the Maria model. It's Maria that was loyal to God's will. And that God's will was to look completely or permanently looking for social justice and the justice with equity. And that search for loyalty implies that you have to go for an option. And Jesus had an option and was clear, is to option and to opt for people that suffer, for the option to go through for the victim, for the ones that are the liberation path. So then the theology, the current theology for Maria is exactly that one, is the loyalty to that option that her son had, that option that basically that takes her to follow that path that Jesus basically wrote down. And that changes completely, and we are basically responsible, be responsible with our bodies, and we have to respect that path to search, to look for life, but life with responsibility, with complete life. And that's what we're doing. No, we haven't done it. We haven't been able to do that because that's a very long road. That's something that is going to happen very slowly, but I think that we are pushing this through and that we've been working on it, and we have been working on it from that, be able to overcome preconceptions that send us to build a freedom path. And then I will add this with with the question that you ask us. What that currently with the groups that we are working with in that network, we've been working with two groups, two male groups of new masculinity. And it's to see how, for example, from the women, from the thought of these women of action and security, they are participating in the assembly, being part of participating as new masculinity, be in this new ethical path. And I think it's very important what the director was saying. The one that was sitting here, Kathleen, that if we do not involve men, we're not going to be able to do this. And women in the circle do say that constantly. If my husband does not get the education, then what I can do if he doesn't get into this? So it's a way of doing it. It's a challenge. It's a responsibility, but it's part of the peace process. And it's part of what Brother Salvadorian Brother says, that is basically part of the awareness. We have to work together in order to go into this path. In order to work together, we have to elevate women's dignity. We have to elevate their self-esteem. And we have to tell them, calm down. We're able to do this. We are able to do this, and we can face this challenge together. So that's it.
I also think that is to be able to work all together, because we're subject to politics and right, but we're also subject to be able to participate. But we can do this in different churches, in this social framework, and it's been a long path in women movements in Colombia, but to consolidate this in different churches, it's a process that we need to do and that we are being able to achieve. And definitely, we have started to reflect and to think about that different people and advisors that work with us are men and their male voices in these groups, but also we needed to have moments to be by ourselves as women and to talk just among women and as women. But we think, of course, men and women have to build some equity and justice in our societies. Thank you so much for your intervention. My name is Isabel, and for the past 2 years, I've been working with human rights in Colombia in different communities, and the word to go with, basically, I just want to ask, what does this mean for all of you? Some of you mentioned to have safe spaces for dialogue, but what does that mean, safe spaces? And how do you see your role within the restorative justice among the circles of women, and to identify yourselves as different women, not just as victims or aggressors?
I'm the executive director of International Association for Human Values. First, my apologies for being late. I had another engagement. I just wanted to briefly mention that the founder of our organization, Shirshir Ravi Shankar, he's a humanitarian and spiritual leader. He was one of those leaders in Colombia, being part of the talks. And he was invited on, I believe, June 26th to receive Colombia's highest award for his work in Colombia in particular. And met with Ivan Marquez, and a couple of days later they met again in Cuba, and they held a press conference together where during which Ivan Marquez announced his adoption of Gandhian nonviolent ways said needed some time to really make sure that this can be more sustainable. Of course, it's not an easy process. Just wanted to make this comment and invite you to also meet with us, and I don't know how long you are here, but meet with our leader as well. Thank you for the work you do.
Isabel is talking about something that is very important in all the process in Colombia, which is to accompany, and you were asking a question, what does this mean, safe spaces? What does it mean? And that word, safety, has to do with something that we were talking about in our presentation, which is to demilitarized spaces. to be able to create safe spaces and to demilitarize our lives so that women can talk calmly, with respect, that they can listen to them, and overall, to be able to respect their own feelings deeply without trying to swing them to the answers that we are expecting and that we believe are the real ones. That's why Susan taught all of us those principles on how important it is to listen from that deep feeling of respect and that strength to be able to understand situations, different situations, and to respect them and to help women to be able to go and get the tools that are needed. It's not to make them feel as the victim or the poor girl that we're going to help. No, not at all. But to help that woman that have rights and that need to know about these rights, that has to start learning about these rights and to have self-esteem, a strong self-esteem, so that she can go out and defend these rights that she has. This is something basic, because if not, then this person is going to be one more victim of conflict or people that just want to solve her life. So this is that re-victimization, and that's what we want to achieve. And personally, I think that this can be done through reshaping and empowering women in their search. And that's how we're going to be able to achieve avoiding the re-victimization. And that's the only thing that can achieve it, because the rest, well, nothing is certain. So if we don't go through these different processes of taking care of ourselves, monthly we have some workshops with female victims in which they recognize what they are and they start working through their pain and suffering and their potential, and they start developing that path of searching within themselves, their spirituality. And that's when they come out and they say, I'm able to do it. And that's when they start to build their own path. And I think personally, there's no other way to achieve this. This is to empower women through self-esteem and to let them know, don't worry, we're with you, to support you, and we're going to fight together. But from public forums and different spiritual spaces, so that they can give you the support you need. It's also important to say that not all of them have to tell their pain stories in the circles or suffering. We respect their stories if they want to tell them or not. It's acceptable, but this process of justice and to tell them what their rights are and to obviously advise them legally and provide them with legal tools helps them. So this is just like a complete process. It's not only the psychosocial process, it's also the legal process, training that provides them with more tools to think about how they can basically repair or heal themselves or to go and get help, but that there are mechanisms that the government provides so that they can be listened and to restore themselves. So not all of them have to tell their stories, but the ones that want to tell their stories is possible, and we have some confidentiality packs. or agreements, because of course these are spaces that are very sensitive spaces, and we have built trust. We know each other for years, and we've been walking together for some years, for 6 or 7 years. So this allows this trust amongst ourselves. But we're very careful with this re-victimization, and they don't have to tell their story 10 times because it's not about this. And we understand that it's a safe space where there's a lot of uncertainty. The church, that circle of friends, that opportunity to be able to chat, that safe space in which there's a lot of safety, because outside there's a lot of violence. And so this is like a safe space for many of them. I want to add something else that I think is very important. These days, three women started talking, and I was there. And I was in a rush. I needed to leave. So I just stayed there, but I think they could tell that I was kind of desperate. And when they finished, one of them told me, "Thank you, Norma, for thinking that wasting time is not really wasting time." And that taught me a lesson, a very big lesson, just to be there and to stay still and to basically be with them from that side, and just listening and feeling what they were feeling all together. Una pregunta más, nada más.
Buenas tardes.
Good afternoon. My name is Marcela Calle, and I'm working with Inter-Youth as a fellow in a fellowship program, and I'm very interested in reconciliation programs in Colombia. But what can we do to change? And when you were talking about that basically idea to publicize or publish more about the violent actions, that the peace actions, you have been developing some strategies or some projects in terms or regarding communication to show these peace strategies amongst different groups, so that this can be strengthened and can be spreaded publicly. Well, basically, what we recognize that in GemPaz in different regions is when we are working really hard, and there are some regions, obviously, that are stronger in this process than others. So, yes, we have been able to have this process not only in the circles with women, but we've been able to have some political incidents and working more with the state. So we, Bogota, it's strong, but also Cali through this women's circles, and we've been able to work all together in which the church is involved and the state to create this transformation. And we're also working through other means, through the media. We're working a website, and we're trying to publish this and make it more visible. And Norma can talk more about this. We have decided to participate in some strategic spaces in different movements, and from GemPaz, we said we're not going to participate in all of them because obviously we cannot do it, but we're going to choose the ones that are very strategical, because as a group we cannot have such a great impact, but with some alliances we can achieve it. So Norma, I don't know if you want to say anything.
Mira,
Well, to be able to change the way the media think, it's impossible. To make them not go ahead and publish bad news or negative news, and to make them to promote good news, it's almost impossible. However, we have to continue. I work in a very poor area. There was a time where we needed the media to go there, and they wouldn't go. So I made a call and said, there's a possible, there's a person that might be dead. And right away, an hour later, everyone was there. All the media was there. And when they arrived, they were like, where's the dead person? And I never said there was a dead person. I said that possibly there was a dead person. But I told them, well, but I have a very nice story. They're not going to make us leave this place. So then the dynamic was changed. And in this way, a lot of women gathered together from different sectors. We are from the army, businesswomen, farmers, indigenous women, Afro-Colombian women, ex-combat women. Well, we are a very diverse group. In Colombia, it's like a big mix, a very big and diverse group. And we gathered together and we said, we have to achieve these points in which peace in Colombia has to be achieved. And it's an ethical group, so that women in the ecumenical group of women could go through this process. But it took 2 years, but we achieved it at the end. And we achieved that all of these women signed this process. I'm going to read the 15 points, and I'm going to commit to send Susan these points in English, because everything is in English, and it's on the website, but I didn't bring them in English. They're in Spanish. So these points are the following. To acknowledge humanity and the right to life from every single person that live in this country. That's one of the points. The other point to recognize, respect, and value diversity and political differences. No one has the absolute truth. To identify and question different interests and myths that keep violence going. To recover the notion of the state. To acknowledge diversity, to defend safety in every single human based on respect and their human rights, to promote respect and efficiency of these human rights and financial justice from businesses and the community as a whole, to transform cultural practices that try to exclude some people and to have more equal relationships between men and female, to reject all violence ways against women and to exchange them and to change them, to rebuild practices for social justice and a legal framework that respect human rights, to reject corruption and manipulation and crimes in all sectors of the country, to recognize and overcome the deep suffering caused by the violence for decades, to promote active dialogues, taking care of and understanding differences and knowing that differences are okay, to be able to disseminate different visions and not to repeat the same tragedy, to promote and demand ethical ways to promote politics in a collective way, to defend and consolidate our active participation in different spaces in the community and political debate, and the notion of opposition as a dynamic to build democracy. If we can put all this together, peace is gonna be achieved. So we have to work together, and we have this as a therapy, as some educational therapy, and to give these points to communities so they can study their own reality. And we consider that this is a very important path, and this is a constant work in this reality.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you especially to our translators in the back who did a Herculean job. It's a long session. We didn't always talk sweetly for them. Yep. Antonis, do you have a final word you want to say?
No, just thank you for staying, and for those who tuned in to the webcast, thank you for tuning in, and please look forward to future Colombia Peace Forum events that we'll continue to have through this year. Our guests from GemPaz will be in DC through Friday, so if any of you have any further questions, they will be in town until then. So thank you again, and we hope you have a great afternoon. Thanks.